you know, thank you for all he's done, you know. That's my sister called me the other night, and that's what we was getting and said, it feels like the Lord's moves in the season to be more and more thankful for what he has done.
Yes.
You know, one thing I love about God's love the most is it doesn't fluctuate like sometimes people love can, right? Like if you do something wrong, they don't, you know, they don't want to deal with you very well.
Right.
You don't do something right there in your corner.
Yeah.
But God's love, we was just talking about, Lee and I was just talking about that tonight, that God's love is consistent.
Yes.
He loves us with an everlasting love.
Yes.
And you know what God asks from us isn't really very much. First of all, he wants us to spend time with him.
Yes.
To develop that relationship. I mentioned the other day, one thing about, you know, we shouldn't have to keep introducing ourselves back and forth. Hey, God, this is me. Where he knows it's you.
Yeah.
But, you know, we want to have a consistent relationship every morning and just go and just praise him. One of the things I was looking at was 2 Corinthians chapter 7. And this is, of course, when Solomon had dedicated the temple. And we look at this verse so much, but it's a powerful verse because he's talking to us.
Right.
He's talking to us. In 2 Chronicles 7:14, I just love this. Whenever I hear it, if my people, who's that? That's the people that believe in Jesus Christ. If my people, who are called by my name, shall humble themselves, pray, seek, crave, and require necessity, my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, forgive their sin, and heal their land. And just think about that. And one of the translations, I love looking up different translations, because they bring out, that was an amplified version. But this is in the International Standard Version. I even love this better, because it brings out the heart of God. It says, when my people humble themselves, the ones called by my name, and pray, seek me, and turn away from the evil practice, I myself will listen from heaven.
Yeah.
That is, I myself, God said, I will listen to you.
Right.
Yes.
Because he always wants one of those lives that are clean. Walk before him in with clean hands. Like the song said, you know, I just feel a lot of times we worry way too much about stuff that's not even going to happen yet.
Right.
You know, I drove a truck for years, years, years now. I teach, but I remember being out east of Peoria at a big snowstorm. We was going west on 74, and the snow was coming in. I mean, all the weather reports, everything was coming. You go west on 74, a snowstorm. So we was at a truck stop, and this young man, it's amazing. If we listen, God can use anybody around us to teach us a lesson, to say something to us. And so we're talking, says, man, we got to beat this storm. You know, we're going to be driving a semi in there. And this young kid behind the counter, I mean, he looked like maybe 18 years old. You know, we were talking about these big truck drivers talking about a storm, and it had nothing happened. It just was clear. And he said, why do you guys worry about stuff that hadn't happened yet? Oh, man, better listen to that. Better listen to that. You know, he wasn't no truck driver or nothing, but he had a valid point.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's what we tend to do a lot of times. We worry about stuff that hadn't even happened yet. Oh, what happens if I don't pay? You know, this doesn't happen, and they turn off this and turn off that. What difference does it make? Mm-hmm. One thing about it, God's got you covered.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of times we worry. Someday we're about the cable's going to be shut off. You know, we're about all that stuff. So what if it is? Maybe that's time we need to be praying some more. We need to be talking to God. Sometimes we can watch that stuff way too much instead of having that conversation between the people you don't have. It always is fascinating to me that now, you know, I love the modern cell phone. They have a lot of good features. But it's kind of bad if somebody's sitting beside you and they text you.
Yeah.
When they're sitting beside you and they text you in the same house and they text you. And I'm thinking, man, that's pretty bad.
Yeah.
That's pretty bad when they can't say right beside you, gotta ask you, and they're right beside you. So what's going on there? You know? Can't you even speak and say, you know, what's going on? We kind of losing a little bit of that.
Yeah.
You watch people at a bus stop or in a restaurant or someplace, what are they doing?
Yeah.
You know, they're texting. It's like, you're not even paying attention to the people. God put those people in your life for a reason. My sister was talking about one of my cousins wasn't doing great good, and I remember he was a godly man. He didn't start out that way, but turned his life around, and he wasn't doing very good, you know, and the doctor said 4 to 6 weeks. I said, you know what? That doesn't mean it's 4 to 6 weeks. Sometimes them live out the doctor, live out the Christians are not at the same level. Everybody's not at the same thing. They can't all receive everything, but you pray. So one day they can start seeing more and more and more and more. But there's one thing about a new Christian is that enthusiasm they have for the Lord. They want to witness to everybody. Because they want everybody to know what they got. And somewhere in life, God, oh, we get a little more educated, you know. I don't know. I remember being out at Roy Rogers Restaurant out on the East Coast. And I know it was God. The one thing about people, I said, well, Tim, how do you know it's God? How do you know it's God? Well, let me tell you something. All the years I've been a Christian, one thing, I've never had the devil come and tell me to go pray for somebody. I've never had that. Well, you better go pray. I never had that happen. What I had, you know it's God, which is go pray for somebody and see him be healed. The devil don't care about nobody. He likes misery. Like misery like company, that's what the devil does. Right? But I was in the Roy Rogers Restaurant, and I was with this other truck driver, and this young lady come in, and her dad, and she kind of walked like she had cerebral palsy. And man, I know it was God. He said, you need to go pray. Go over and pray. Go to her dad, ask her dad, and ask if it's all right to pray for that young lady. And boy, I mean, we were sitting there talking, and it just kept talking about the Spirit. You know, it was God. Yes. And the longer I sit there, says, I talked to my partner, says, man, I feel I should go pray. I should really go pray for that young lady. And, you know, he kind of debated and said, I don't know, that might not be appropriate, you know, and all that stuff. But it kept getting, I said, I got to do it, man, I got to. Yeah. They throw me out of a restaurant, let me throw out of Roy Rogers Restaurant. I go somewhere else. But what I'm saying is, it was so deep, I had to do it. And so they ate, and the dad got up, and I went up to him respectfully and said, sir, I'm not trying to say anything wrong, but I'm a Christian, and I feel I should pray for your daughter. I feel that God wants to do something. Can I pray? And he just kind of looked at me. He didn't say, well, you get away from me, crazy man. No, he didn't say that. He said, thank you, young man. I appreciate it. But we just got back from a revival in Florida, and we had it brought up to stage, and we prayed for her. But I want to thank you for that. That's as far as I can go. That's as far as I can go. So I took it. I said, well, I've been obedient to what the Lord does. And that's what the Lord blessed. Because he said, obedience is greater sacrifice. Sometimes it looks like he asks us to do some strange stuff. But one thing we realize in Isaiah, it says, his ways are above our ways. Sometimes it may not make sense, but you don't know where people are. In that same situation, I was still out there, and I was in line at like a Walgreens out there, and this lady, and I felt I should ask this lady, she was in line. I said, lady, I'm a Christian, but there's a young lady, would you mind praying? You know, I didn't know where she, and she said, sure, no problem, I like praying. I ain't probably not told. So now you have two people that was connected. I don't know what happened to the young lady, but one thing about it is when we're obedient to the things of God and realize he has his way of doing things, and that's what he expects from us. You're just like your kid. Isn't it great? Would you go clean your room up? Isn't it great when the kid says, yes, Mom? Not a problem. Isn't that great when they do that? Hey, you know, I'll cook supper, I'll wash dishes. Isn't that great? It doesn't sound so good. Well, you know, Mom, you know, but I did them last night. Bobby's turn. You know, it's Joey's turn. You know, after a while, you just say, oh, let's forget it. I do it myself. You know? No, you want to be obedient. And that's what God wants from us. I just feel that's where he wants. If my people would humble themselves and pray and spend time with God, we could see a lot more miracles, a lot of lives change. Because I'm telling you, there's a lot of people. The one thing, like I say, get back to faith. One thing about it, I'm a failure. I'm a failure. I said, you can't be a failure. You know why? Failure is a thing. It's not a person.
That's right.
So how can you be a failure? You might have failed at something. That don't mean you're a failure.
Right.
You know, you just get up and try it again. You know, because the problem is we get so close to getting our dreams and we give up. We get so close. I know Moses had to feel that. All them decades, you know, about four decades, wonder where God's at. Wonder where he was with me back then. Where's he at? He ain't forgotten. You know, he takes out everything that's not him, and sometimes it takes years to get those attitudes out. You know? And then one day, when Moses turned aside, I love that. When he turned aside and realized, hey, that's God there. And God, you know, he said, this is holy ground. And that's what we got to look at. God's holy. This is holy ground. How, wherever God is, it's holy ground. And that's where you got to look at the holiness. That's why when you go to heaven, that's why when you get a picture of heaven, you get a picture of them crying, holy, holy, holy. And they cast the crowds at their feet. They're realizing how holy God is. Once you get a picture of how holy
The guy that founded this program is actually a Christian, and we get a student manual, and there's sentences in there when he's explaining things, and he goes, and thank God he created us this way, you know, and he puts things like that, and there's a scripture in the back cover and all that. But, you know, as I started to know some of the people that are with me in the class, we've gone to talk, I was talking to this girl this morning, and she said, "What made you come here?" I said, "Well, I needed a change, and one of the things is that God made me a promise. He gave me a vision of a daughter, and I need to be alive to be there with her. So I got to take care of myself."
That's right. Hallelujah.
And then as I was waiting to take a shower before going to work there, I met this other guy that happens to go to church in Johnston. He said that they take over the movie theater for their service,
mm-hmm.
and he leads worship in there. So there's God's moving in that place.
Right.
So I'm gonna get to know some people, and things are gonna happen.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord. Guess,
thank
you,
Lord.
Thank you,
you know,
for putting
Lord.
Me there.
Yeah. You know, God is always a grand chess master.
Right.
You know, I will always think about chess. You know, to me, my son-in-law, he was playing chess and gonna teach me. So I wanted to play chess. I said, y'all take too long. You know, I didn't realize, you know, chess. And I watched him play it. And he said, one thing we do, we don't concentrate on the move we're making now. They're looking moves ahead.
Yeah.
If this person does that, they're going to respond to us. That's it. That's how God does. He's a grand chess master.
Yeah.
He knows how to get this person over there, that person over there. He knows how to orchestrate.
Yeah.
You know, and he knows what's best. And I tell you what, he can make some relationships that last a lifetime.
Right.
You know, and you never know what influence you can have on that person or the ones can inspire you.
Amen.
You know, that's why we just let God flow through us, let God use us.
Because
you just never know, really. You never know who you're going to touch.
That's right.
You know, and I just remember one time I wasn't living the way I was supposed to, and I remember I was at a hotel, and this young kid come walking by, and, you know, he's smiling, I said, "How you doing?" You know, and he just said, "He's unblessed." You know, and I thought, wow, I come here, he looked like he's maybe 12 years. I'm blessed. And I got to thinking, man, I'm blessed too.
Yeah.
I need to start thinking about that and doing other stuff.
Yeah.
You know, and realize when you start thinking how blessed you are, man, we got enough to praise God for 1,000 years.
Right.
You know, instead of thinking about all the negative stuff, things if we start praising God, that's when I think things start changing.
Amen.
Because Psalm 34:1 says, "I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth."
Yeah.
And that says, bless the Lord at all times, not just in good times, bad times, all the time.
Yeah.
You start blessing the Lord, and I'm telling you what, things will happen. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
And they were both sharing with me how they've been both in their jobs for like 3 years. Matt transferred from Office Max here up to Office Max up there. And he was doing really well, but they just felt like they needed a change.
Mm-hmm.
And so on the way home, well, after I left there, I just prayed, "Lord, you give them new beginnings."
Hallelujah.
What is it? What's it like? It's so refreshing to have a new start.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
And I'm thinking, I felt the Lord say to me, "Be ready for a call."
Hallelujah. Mm-hmm.
And I kind of had just, you know, I still prayed, but I just kind of forgotten about the call. And Monday, I was doing my route, and my phone rang, and I just looked at the name, and I said, "Matt." So I'm thinking, okay, see what's up. And he says, "Cassie got a job. She starts a new job next week, and she's going to be a said, I start mine in 3 weeks. I got an offer letter. I said, what? Are you doing a paper mill? Because he was talking about a paper mill when I was there.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, that just doesn't fit him. And he said, no, I'm going to work for Kenworth.
Hallelujah.
And I said, what are you going to be doing? He says, parts counter. I said, that is right up your alley.
Yeah, that's good.
And I said, you know, praise God, buddy. I said, I've been praying for you and Cassie. And then I asked him, I said, you know, do you mind me asking? I said, you said you went back to church. I said, what kind of church is this you're going to? And he says, a Christian church.
Hallelujah.
And I said, okay. So then I started praying. I started praying some more, and I thought, all right. And then I started thinking about Nathan that's here in Johnston, and he's been faithful at his job for 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
And so I started praying for him, and I said, Lord, you know, I think he needs a boost up too.
Mm-hmm.
You know? I mean, he's been detailing cars and washing, and he's faithful, and he's, you know, going to church, and he's with the middle school ministry and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And as a matter of fact, last Sunday he told me that the middle school pastor asked him to pray for the whole congregation.
There you go.
Sunday morning. Yeah. And he said it was awesome. But anyways, I saw him today because I took my skate to Gavis to have a recall done.
Mm-hmm.
And he said that he put his letter in the parts department.
Mm-hmm.
For confirmation.
Yeah.
And the guy said, well, I haven't made a decision yet. And he said, but Nate said, I said, so you're going to go in the parts department? And he said, yeah.
So there you go.
Praise the Lord, you know?
Yeah.
I said, Lord, you had both my sons contact me and both going to be doing the same kind of business in different areas.
There you go.
Hallelujah.
So praise God.
Praise
God.
Lord.
Thanks God. Thanks God.
He had to leave early today because of the funeral arrangements they're going for. She's an elderly lady, and his cancer had gotten hold of her and stuff. I don't believe any of them know the Lord, but somehow, some way, for him to be glorified in this situation, just an opportunity to speak or whatever to open the door. I just pray for wisdom in this situation and that his name be lifted up and that he makes his face known to this family.
Yes. Hallelujah. We definitely.
lift up my friend Spencer. She is going through some stuff, that she's doing some things that is basically self-destructing behavior. But, you know, we talk every day through messaging. We sit in different floors. But she kind of lives vicariously through me because she gets really excited every time that I share with her things that God has done for me and all that, although she's a non-believer. But I do know that she's looking for an answer so that life makes sense to her once again.
Mm-hmm.
Because right now she's in a spot where she doesn't care about anything that happens at all. So if she were to die today, it wouldn't matter to her, you know.
Yeah.
So just let's just lift her up and pray for revelation, and that that answer that she's looking for, God gives it to her, and she comes to Him.
Yeah. God's able to do that. That's what God puts people in our minds, and we can pray. You know, there's one thing about it. You know, our prayers go above the ceiling, and they go straight to the throne room. And you got somebody that really is in that place that they just need revelation and realize that, hey, I need God.
That's
and it comes to that point, you know, and they have friends. And the thing about prayer, you know, we look at how we're here now, Christian. We don't know how many people through the years have prayed for us to get here.
Right.
We don't know. I mean, it could have been generations back.
Yeah.
You know, my grandma, she passed away at 65, but that's the first recollection of being in church was on her lap.
Yeah.
That's my memory. She helped found a church, and that church is still going. I think it's probably 100 years old.
Thank
you know, and she had a seed. She planted a seed there at that church.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't get saved under that ministry.
Yeah.
But I remember just going to church.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what makes the difference. That seed, it may take some years to go,
but
somebody comes to water.
That's
you know, Paul planted, Paul's water, but God gave the increase.
That's
and that's what we got to look at. Because, you know, when we're obedient to what God wants us to do and pray for that person, because sometimes you get woke up in the middle of the night, you know, and pray for a person. Maybe clearing us out, you know, pray for these people, pray for that. You never know what God is going to do in them people's lives. Because there's a lot of people out there that don't have direction, that's really hungry.
Yes.
And, you know, that's what, Peter always gave a reason. You know, when somebody said, what makes you different? You don't get upset like everybody else does. You're not running around doing all this other stuff. What makes you different? Boy, you talk about open doors.
Yeah.
You know, and that's what it is. You know, I think about Paul and Silas, you know, when they was in jail. You know, and it's interesting how God used to come. At midnight, you know, they were singing praises. Here they was all shackled. Well, I'm telling you, you can sing a lot of other things in jail other than praise. It don't look very good. But, you know, people, can you imagine there, man? You know, and they hear the praises echoing through there.
Yeah.
You know, and then the jailhouse rock
happens.
Right? God shook the prison there.
Yeah.
You know, and the Philippian jailer come in there and said, you know, what must I do to be saved? There's something going on here. And he ended up wiping the stripes off them. Can you imagine that? But they were singing, and that's what I think changed everything. Because they could have said, oh, me, man, I'm in a bad situation.
Yeah.
But they realized God was still there.
Yeah.
You know, no matter where you're at, God can still use you.
Yes.
You know, that's one thing. I got to share this real quick. But I fell down the stairs once, and I busted I cut the tendons and the thigh muscle to the knee. So my knee would just swing like this, and I had to go to Iowa City Hospital. But I'm sitting in bed, and I'm telling you what, I mean, it was a horrible injury. And I couldn't walk, and they fixed me all up. But I remember sitting in the bed, and I watched this Christian program. So God can reach you exactly where you're at. So this program, never seen it before, never seen it after. So I'm sitting there, and listen, and this guy on the TV screen, who I've never seen before, and he says this, even if you fell down the stairs, God can still use you.
Yeah.
Where'd that come from?
Yeah.
How do you know that?
Yeah.
How'd that guy on the TV screen know that?
Yeah.
I was at Iowa City Hospital. How did he possibly know that?
Yeah.
God knew where I was at.
Yeah.
You know, he knew the room. And I didn't even turn the TV on that channel. It was already set on that channel.
Yeah.
So you tell, you know, nobody can ever convince me God ain't real.
That's right.
They can never. They can say a lot of things. Can you believe in UFOs and all that other stuff? I said, well, we thank you that your love doesn't fluctuate. You love us with an everlasting love. We thank you for that. This situation with Spencer down out here, oh, hallelujah, there's going to be a life change in that situation. There's going to be a heart change. Like you said, created me a new heart. That's where it starts at. Created me a new heart. God, you know what we need. Oh, be with Jody and I'll just the different requests to help. And that lady at work, hallelujah, you know how to put people at the right place. You know how to plant seed. You know how to heal. Hallelujah. It ain't over. God says it's over, let me tell you. Man can say all they want, but can't nobody put a hat on God's head. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Because that's what we're looking at today. The situation, the mics, the co-worker and all that. God can take care of all that. There's nothing. Is there anything too hard for God? Hallelujah. The Bible says, for with God. Hallelujah. Not apart from him. It says, for with God. All things. Didn't say some things. Didn't say a few things. It said all things are possible. And that's what it's about. Father God, we need to believe you for all things. We need to believe you that we can receive that healing. You've already done it all. We need to receive that healing. We need to receive that deliverance. Hallelujah. Lord, we need to receive your love every day and realize that you love us with that everlasting love. And when there's doubts that come in our life, whether God loves us, we got to stick to your word. Because your word said God is love. That's what it's about. Oh, Father God, we thank you tonight that we can come and praise you. We thank you tonight that, Lord, you have blessed us so much. Bless us above what we can even imagine or think. Hallelujah. You give us more than enough. God, you are more than enough. Hallelujah. Ear has not heard, eye has not seen. Think about all the wonderful things God has in store. And all we can do, Lord, is cry out, holy, holy, holy. Because that's what it's about. If my people just will humble themselves and pray and seek your face, that's what it's about. Said in your word, seek ye first. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. And all his righteousness, all these other things. Let us not seek the things. Let us seek you, our God, our Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ. That's what it's about. Oh, hallelujah. We praise you tonight. We lift you up and we give you the glory. We give you the glory. We give you the glory. Hallelujah. 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 And you're wonderful, 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 wonderful. Wonderful, wonderful. That's there for the Lord. Hallelujah.
From my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. Show me your face, Lord. Show me your
Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we just love you tonight. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for never leaving us or forsaking us. Thank you for your faithfulness, Lord. We just bless you tonight and ask you to have your way in this entire service, that you would be lifted up and magnified, Lord, and we would come to know you in a deeper and more loving way. And we give you all the thanks and the praise for every good thing that comes as a result of this service. In Jesus' mighty name. Everybody say, praise the Lord. Amen. God bless you all. You may be seated. Thank you, worship team. Give them a hand clap. Praise God. Thank the Lord. Thank the Lord. Amen. Amen. How many of you know words are important? Praise the Lord. Well, thank you, Mike. Hallelujah. Not only are words important, but the way we use words are important. And so how we present the Lord, it's more than just saying that he exists, but it's how we say it, amen, in agreement with what the Word of God said. I saw a church sign one time said they were having a promotion for a fundraiser for their building, and one said, I upped my offering, up yours. So, there you go. Words mean something. Praise the Lord. It's just not just words, but it's how you use them, right? Praise the Lord. So, we want to be effective and not abrasive. And but you know, when God opens a door, he expects us to go through it. He expects us to take advantage of those opportunities. Amen. For him to be glorified and be realized by people in the truth. Yes. Amen? And so that's what I want to talk about tonight. Praise the Lord. Let's quickly go to Acts chapter 20 and verse 24. And praise God. He's on the throne. Amen. Yes. God is good. I'm going to stick right in here with, once we get up here on Acts 20, 24. Praise the Lord. Acts 20 and verse 24. Praise the Lord. But none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself. This is Paul speaking, so that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry which I have received of the Lord, amen, to testify the gospel of the grace of God. Let's read it one more time. But none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. That is what Paul declared his ministry to be. That's what he spent his life, amen, presenting to people everywhere he went. The gospel of the grace of God. Praise the Lord. Amen. There isn't any other gospel. That's the only gospel there is. Praise the Lord. So let's look now at 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and we'll read verses 6 through 13. And then pretty much I'll stay right here within the confines of 1 Corinthians, with maybe a couple of exceptions, but mainly right here. We'll just follow these scriptures through as we go on tonight. Howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor of the princes of this world that come to naught. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory. By the way, if you follow the scriptures, we talked about it a little bit Sunday, that glory is being revealed through God's grace to us throughout eternity. That's right. Where this glory is revealed. Amen? So which none of us, the princes of this world, knew, for had we known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, I hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit, for the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man, which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man, but the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God, which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. So Praise the Lord. Amen. Wisdom is probably the main theme, if not one of the main themes, in these opening chapters of 1 Corinthians. And Paul goes to a lot of trouble and a lot of time to differentiate between the gospel, or actually to differentiate between the gospel and the wisdom of this world. Mm-hmm. Praise the Lord. If you're looking for wisdom in sophisticated speech, powerful rhetoric, Paul says you're not going to find it in his sermons.
Right.
Praise the Lord. Mm-hmm. I'm feeling better about myself already. Hallelujah. All right, let's go to 1 Corinthians 2, and we'll just read verses 1 through 5. 1 Corinthians 2, 1 through 5. And we'll just break these down a little bit without getting too picky, but to express what Paul is really trying to say here. Amen. Brethren, when I came to you, I came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Praise the Lord. So Paul says, and he goes on to say, and I'll give you scriptures after each one of these, because we have a tendency to think that these were just like the fireball evangelist, great name, you know, perfect speech, all the right metaphors and everything when they preached, and they were people like us. Mm-hmm. Now, no doubt Paul got excited when he preached the word and probably got loud and got excited like any of us do, amen, when we feel the Spirit moving, you know. But he said, I didn't do this like I was a professional.
Right.
I just gave it to you the way the Lord gave it to me. Amen? Paul even goes on to say, you're not going to find this wisdom, the wisdom of the world, you're not going to find it in the preaching of the cross. Now, that sounds blasphemous to us, but I'm talking about the world, their wisdom. You're not going to find it there. Amen? 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Verses 18 through 25. And we have to remember this because we're talking to people who operate totally in the wisdom of the world.
Yes.
For the most part, the people that we're dealing with are not, they're not, I'm talking about unbelievers, they're not operating from the wisdom of God.
Right.
They're operating in the wisdom of this world.
Right.
Praise the Lord. So for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. I mean, isn't that difficult for us when we know what the cross represents, what it has meant for us? But you talk to somebody who's an unbeliever and they think it's the dumbest thing they've ever heard. It's just stupid.
Yeah.
Right? It's the wisdom of the world.
Yep.
There, it's the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. But unto us which are saved, it is the power of God.
Yes.
For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent.
Yeah.
Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world?
Yeah.
Amen? For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. So, and we know that's true. With all of their knowledge and getting of knowledge and all of their world wisdom, they're not smart enough to see the nose at the end of their face. That this is all about God. By the world's wisdom, they don't know God by the world's wisdom. You can have, come on, most of us have met people who even were theologically wise in terms of theology. In other words, they could have a PhD in theology. My pastor as a kid growing up was a theology professor at Drake. But he had no clue about a relationship that we're talking about here with God. Now, I don't mean that disrespectfully. I'm just saying there was no salvation message. It was just historic facts and records and moral codes and that type of thing. No salvation message. Praise the Lord. For the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block, unto the Greeks foolishness. But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men. And the weakness of God is stronger than man.
That's right.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Paul says, not only won't you find it in his preaching, the world's wisdom, you won't find the world's wisdom in the cross, the preaching of the cross. And he says, you won't find the world's wisdom in many of us. Praise the Lord. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, 26 through 31. For you see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. And base things of the world and things which are despised hath God chosen. Yea, and things which are not to bring to naught things that are. That no flesh should glory in his presence. But of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God has made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, that according as it is written, he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Amen. So the gospel is wisdom for the mature. He says that in perfect, for those who are perfect. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 6. The gospel is wisdom for the perfect or for the mature. Howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, that are mature. Yet not the wisdom of this world, nor are the princes of this world that come to naught. Amen?
Amen.
But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world. Amen. So God's word is not of this age. It has nothing to do with the wisdom that the world wants to see.
Right.
Praise the Lord. It doesn't belong to this earthly realm. God's wisdom isn't of the rulers of this age.
No.
That's why most of them mock it or take it as very little significance. They may profess it, but they don't really believe it. Praise the Lord. It's a voting block.
Yeah.
It's somebody to get to come and vote for you. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
It has nothing to do. This gospel has nothing in common with scheming or cunning devices of the enemy.
That's right.
That's what he tells us in that scripture we just read. If the princes of this world knew really what it was about, they would have kept their mouths shut and left Jesus alone.
Right.
Amen. They thought they were being wise. They thought they were making a really wise move here. We're going to stop this thing. And with all their wisdom, it proved that it was the dumbest possible thing they could have done.
Exactly.
It was the most foolish. Amen. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. In whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. Same book, but chapter 10, verses 4 through 6. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, and having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your disobedience is fulfilled. Praise the Lord. When your obedience is fulfilled. Now let me just show you what this is. Having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience. What was that? That's us. That's the flesh. But when your obedience is fulfilled, when was our obedience fulfilled? At the cross. Jesus was totally and perfectly obedient to God. Now, does that mean that we shouldn't be obedient? No. But it means that even when we fail to be obedient, God sees us as obedient. Amen? Because of that. Because of what Jesus did. That's why in Deuteronomy where it talks about if you obey in all of these ways, then you will be blessed. Blessed in the city, blessed in the field, you know, blessed in the storehouse. Blessed coming in, blessed going out, the head, not the tail, above, not beneath, and so on and so forth. But then it says, the list of what happens if you fail. If you fail to be totally obedient, you get sickness, you get disease, you get the results of the curse. But Paul tells us that Jesus came and delivered us from the curse of the law. So the only thing that we have as a result of, the, as far as the law is concerned, based on what Jesus did, are the benefits of being perfectly obedient to that law.
Yes.
Amen? Now that makes absolutely no sense to the natural mind, but it's perfect sense to God because this is all a gift of grace.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen? Praise the Lord. So God's wisdom is unique. It's not immediately obvious to everybody, or is it generally appreciated by everybody? But it's still the wisdom of God. Amen? 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 7. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory. So it's, you know, we think about Revelation, and we talk about it obviously a good bit because, I mean, it's what a Christian lives by. This is the revelation of Jesus Christ,
right,
cover to cover. Amen? It's all about revelation. But a lot of times we speak the wisdom of God to others, and it is a mystery. Think about this. The greatest revelation you're ever going to get is what puts you here tonight.
Right.
Not because you're in this church or because you're listening to me or sharing with us, but because you have had a revelation of Jesus Christ. That he is real, that his favor is for you, that God is on your side. Without that revelation, there is all the rest of the revelation is worthless.
Right.
And in fact, without that revelation, you would not even care to have revelation.
Yeah.
So that's a great mystery, but the mystery has been revealed. So it's easy, though, to get frustrated when other people don't see what we see. Because it seems so obvious to us.
Right.
You know, I mean, it's just, it makes you crazy sometimes, but surprise, it's a mystery.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, it's a secret. It's hidden wisdom.
Yeah.
Revealed by the Spirit. So let me just say this to you before we go any further. You say, well, you know, Nathan, I'd really like to operate more in the Spirit. I'd really like to be led more by the Spirit. I just need a little more revelation, a little more. You've got all you need. God has already proven to you that you understand revelation, that you are in tune with his Spirit, or you would not be a believer. There's nothing, as Tim said earlier, there's nothing shall be impossible to you. Amen? If you're focused on God, if you're seeking God. Nothing. Nothing. And it has nothing to do with your IQ, your GPA in school. Has nothing to do with your sophistication. Has nothing to do with your education. It has totally to do with the Spirit of God.
Right.
Amen? Amen? He takes the foolish things of this world to confound those that claim to be wise.
Right.
Praise the Lord. The word of the world is not like the word of God.
Right.
Even when they try to do morally good things, they screw it all up.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. One is new and now. The other is ancient and everlasting. One is fleeting. In fact, the scripture says it's doomed to pass away. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 2 again in verse 6. Is that it I'm looking at?
Yep.
Albeit we speak the wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor of the princes of this world that come to naught. They're going away. It's going away. The wisdom of this world will pass.
Yes.
Amen. It's fleeting. It's doomed to pass away.
Yes.
But the other is fixed and solid and decreed before time was.
Exactly.
Before the ages.
Yes.
1 Corinthians 2:7. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Amen. If people want the wisdom of passing fashions, impressive brains, talent, then look to the world.
Yep.
Praise the Lord. But if we want and need a wisdom that is beyond us, that will never fail us, then we have to look into things that God has revealed to us by His Spirit.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
1 Corinthians 2, verse 10. But God has revealed them unto us by His Spirit, for the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. See, the testimony of 1 Corinthians is that only God can tell us about God.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. You know, I mean, this is true. Because you can listen. Hey, I mean, I lived quite a few years without being saved. And I heard a lot of preaching. It wasn't like I never heard anybody preach. But it just went right over my head. Mm-hmm. I wanted to believe it. I would have liked to believe it. But it just didn't seem real. Amen? God has revealed them unto us by His Spirit, for the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. What guy, what human being knows the things of a man except the spirit of a man? And likewise, how are you ever going to know the things of God without the Spirit of God? That's why the Scripture says no man comes to God except the Spirit draws him. We can't even take credit for that. I mean, that's why if you don't understand grace, you're missing the gospel. Mm-hmm. Without God's grace, we would have never come to God. It was by His Spirit that drew us.
Right.
Amen?
Amen?
Praise the Lord. Paul knew the Corinthians needed the wisdom of God. These were probably the most carnal Christians on the block back in Paul's time. You don't have to read very far into Corinthians to see that there's some really pretty stupid, crazy stuff going on here with believers. There's incest, there's drunkenness, there's all kinds of crazy stuff going on in the church where there's just chaos, basically. Uh-huh. Just seemed, you know, like it was all going nutty. Praise the Lord. And Paul knew that these people who were born again, who were saved, they needed wisdom.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And they needed the wisdom of God that could only come from the Spirit of God.
Right. Yes, yes.
Praise the Lord. And so he wrote to them this word that we read tonight. And he wrote it with the understanding that he had uniquely received the Spirit in order for him to proclaim the Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord. So that he could proclaim to them the truth of the gospel.
Right.
Same reason we all got it.
Right.
That's why we all have ministry. That's why we are all called to be kings and priests.
Yeah.
Because we've received this by the Spirit, which is the only way you can really receive it, and the only way you can release it.
Right. Amen.
Amen. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. This is one of my favorite scriptures. I know it isn't a mind blower and anything really deep, but it is the essence, really, of everything that we look at in the Scripture. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God. Amen. If it isn't, it's a waste of time. It's just man's wisdom. But all spirit, without controversy, great is the mystery of God. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, and received up into glory. Praise the Lord. God was manifest in the flesh. He was justified in the spirit. He was seen of angels. He was preached to the non-Jews. And he was believed on in the world. And then he was received up into glory. See, we need the revelation of God in order to know God. That's why the Scripture says Satan believes and trembles.
Exactly.
He knows that there is a God, he just doesn't know God.
Right.
You say, well, he ought to know God. He was in His presence. The very fact that he did what he did proves that he didn't know God.
Right.
Amen? He was so self-focused that he missed God.
Yep. Right.
Amen? The reason for revelation is that we might know God so that we would know His mercy, so that we would know His grace, so that we would know His goodness and be saved. That's why I appreciate what Tim has been talking about the last several times that he's been up here. And I do believe that is a mandate from God, and I believe it is a priority of God.
Yes.
Because without understanding the goodness of God, the faithfulness of God, the mercy of God, the love of God, how are you going to know God? How are you going to present Him to anybody else?
Yeah.
See, if the church has failed, that's where we failed. We thought that, like a parent, if I frighten the child into not doing something bad that can
right.
be harmful to them,
right.
it's worth it. The end justifies the means, in other words. But it's not true with God.
That's right.
It's the absolute opposite. Because you might scare people to an altar, or you might scare them from doing a certain thing at a given time, but they'll never live for God out of fear.
Exactly right.
They'll never have a relationship with God out of fear. Amen? They'll never get to know God.
Right.
Praise the Lord.
Yep.
We have to have revelation, but we have to have the right revelation. It's not enough just to read words and say, hey, I get it. He's God, I'm man, and that's it. We need to read the words that came from the very heart of God. God is love. Amen. It's not an attribute with God. It's Him. It's who He is. He doesn't just love sometimes. He just is love. 1 Corinthians 2 and 9. I was thinking, I don't remember who read it, or, but we're, we're talking about Paul and Silas being in prison, and they prayed, and the earth shook. The Lord has led me to do a little study, and I haven't gotten to where I really want to go there, but I am seeing some pretty profound things here. He says that, you know, there's a time comes when God's going to shake everything that can be shaken, and what is not shaken will stand. You think about in the book of Acts, there's a couple of places where this, where we see this. And the earth shook, and the whole place was shaken. And this one guy, who's the jailer, is assuming, I just will kill myself because the death that the Romans are going to give me for letting these prisoners escape is going to be way worse than just a sword in the stomach. It's going to be probably a crucifixion, something really painful and drawn out, and a lot of suffering and so forth. And Paul, even though the building has been shaken, even though what is looks tangible and should have been the thing standing, has collapsed.
Right.
What is shaken has been shaken. But Paul and Silas are still there.
Right.
And they cry out to the guy, hey, don't hurt yourself. We're all still here.
Yep.
And then what happens? He leads the man and his entire family to the Lord.
That's right.
Amen?
Amen. Yeah.
What can be shaken will be shaken. But what's left can't be shaken.
Right.
It's unshakable.
Right.
What's left? The Word of God.
Yes.
Yep.
The truth of God. The power of God.
Yes.
In any situation, in any circumstance, that is what remains. Amen? Heaven and earth will pass away, but my Word will not pass away.
Right.
Shake the whole world. This whole thing can flatten out.
Yeah.
It can all drop out.
Yep.
Amen? But His Word remains.
Amen?
Amen? Revelation goes on.
Yes.
And we are the result of revelation.
Yes.
Therefore, when everything's shaken, don't fret.
Yeah.
You're on solid ground.
Yes.
You are on the rock that
yes.
cannot be shaken. Praise the Lord.
Thank you,
amen. So, as it is written, I have not seen nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love Him. Now, the church, I'm speaking just in general terms, Judaism, religion, can think that we've seen it all. I mean, go back through the history of religion and the church, and we've seen it all. We've seen the miracles, we've seen the signs, we've seen the wonders, we've seen the you know, the revivals and so on and so forth, and think that they've experienced everything that there is to experience. I mean, if you think about it, that's a lot of our denominations today are based on that reality in their mind, the reality that they have, that those things have passed. We saw it, but they're done now.
Yeah.
Okay, we've seen healing, but healing's not for us today. That's already been an experience of the church, and it's over now. Revelation, so on and so forth, all these things. Amen. That's religion. That's, you know, the way it is. That's what Judaism thought when Jesus showed up. We already know everything that there is to know about this.
Yeah, right.
I mean, we have the law and the prophets and so on and so forth, but they missed the very thing that God was trying to reveal through all of that.
Right.
Amen? You haven't seen. Listen, you, believer, you have not seen, you have not imagined what this God of love has prepared for those who love Him.
Yes.
We haven't got a clue what God's got left to do.
Yeah.
Amen? God is going to do some things that nobody's seen before.
Yeah.
Amen? He's going to do some things that we haven't even dreamed of in our wildest dreams.
Yes.
Amen?
Uh-huh.
Let's just look at this. Isaiah 53, verse 4 through 6. And a lot of the church doesn't even understand this, or at least doesn't embrace it to the degree that God intended it to be. Surely He hath borne our griefs. It's a prophetic word from Isaiah speaking about the Messiah, about Jesus. Amen? Surely He hath borne our griefs, carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem Him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon Him, and with His stripes we are healed. Praise the Lord. All we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on Him the iniquity of us all. And somebody ought to say, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. All right, now let's see what happens as a result of this. How many of you know this happened? This is all done, right?
Yes.
Jesus did this at the cross. The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus fulfilled this prophetic word from Isaiah. But now let's see what we get as a result of this fulfillment. Isaiah 54, verses 9 and 10. Just a piece of this. For this is as the waters of Noah unto me. For as I have sworn that the waters of Noah should no more go over the earth, so have I sworn that I would not be angry with you, nor would I rebuke you. That's us. This is God's promise. He's never going to be angry with you. He's never going to rebuke you. Amen. For the mountains will depart, which is what we just talked about. Everything can be shaken, will be shaken. Amen. Mountains will depart. Hills will be removed. But my kindness shall not depart from you. Amen. Neither shall the covenant of my peace be removed, saith the Lord, that has mercy on thee. We've got nothing to look forward to but more good things from God. No matter how things get shook, no matter how bad things get shaken, amen, we have something to stand on, and that is God's love, God's mercy, God's grace, God's for us, God's favor, hallelujah, is never going to change for you. It has been settled and established. That is the gospel of grace. That's what this world has to learn. That's what they have to know. Those two portions of Scripture are enough, amen, that ought to convince anybody, amen, that the Spirit is dealing with. If God opens the door, I declare that is the word to tell Him. Oh, well, it's Old Testament. Yeah, it's a type and a shadow. It's a foreknowledge, a forewarning, a forementioning of Jesus. Praise God. This is the good news of the cross.
Yes.
The good news for the forgiven. The good news for the redeemed. This is the good news of grace. And you're not going to find it anywhere else but in the Word of God.
Amen. Right. Amen.
Hallelujah. Only by the Spirit working through the Word can really anyone ever become spiritual.
Right.
Every time you talk to somebody and you use this Word, I'm not saying you have to quote it verbatim, but you have to go by the principle. Every time you do that, the Spirit and the Word, Jesus said, the words that I speak, their spirit and their life.
Yes.
That's why it's so important that we talk to people, even to people who are ignorant of the things of God.
Yeah.
Amen? Because you carry the Spirit.
Yes.
Amen? If you don't go with the Word, which is the Word and the Spirit itself, is what's going to change the situation.
Yes.
Yeah.
Jesus was God in the flesh. What did He say? Is the Word became flesh. He was the Spirit and the Word in a man.
Yes.
We are all sons of God.
Yes.
We are all heirs and joint heirs with Jesus. He is our elder brother. We are spirits with the Word. Now, when you speak the Word by the Spirit, as the Spirit leads, in other words, when the door opens, look, you can expect the same results Jesus got.
Yes.
And you don't have to quote a scripture. If you've got that, and that's good, you can. But if you just take the principles, the truth of the Word, and apply it to that person's life, to that situation. I think Tim said it. He said, be ready always to give a reason for the hope that's in you.
Yeah.
Not just a, hey, man, it's good to have hope. Why? Okay, yeah, they know that. They want to know, what's the reason for this hope?
Yeah.
Right. How come you can have hope when everybody else is shaken?
Yeah.
How come you can be positive about the future when everybody else is freaking out about it?
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
You've got to give them a reason for the hope.
Yes.
And that reason is Jesus.
Yes.
That reason is the finished work of the cross. That he did the same for them that he did for us.
Exactly.
They have a right to the same hope. Jesus purchased that hope for them the same as he did for us.
Yes.
But they are spiritually dead.
Come on.
After all, when we got born again, that's what got born again was our spirit. It came alive to God.
Yep.
And God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to a change of mind about him.
Right. Amen.
That's what repentance is, a change of mind about God. So somebody's got to give them something about God to change their mind about.
Exactly.
If all they've ever thought is that God's out to get them, that God is vindictive, that God is judgmental, that God is going to punish, that God is going to hurt them, that God is angry, then take them to Isaiah, amen, 53, and show them that God poured out all that anger on Jesus. So they wouldn't have to be angry with us. And the result is God is not angry anymore at anybody.
Yes.
Not even the worst sinner. God is not angry with them. Wrath will be poured out, but not in this dispensation, not while the church is still here. Everybody's going to get a chance to receive that spiritual reality, that revelation. So that God doesn't have to be angry with any of them. But if they reject it, there's no alternative. God is not sending anybody to hell. They're making a conscious, free will decision to reject their escape. Hell was not made for human beings. It was made for the devil and his demons. God didn't create that for humanity. But you only have two alternatives. You're either going to be with God or you're going to be separate from God.
Right.
To be separate from God, you've got your own God, the God of this world.
Right.
You've made a choice. I'm going to follow him, whether you understand the choice or not.
Right.
Praise the Lord. See, spiritual people are not religious people, per se. I mean, they can be, but they don't have to be.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? Jesus was not a religious person. In fact, that's what irritated and aggravated the Jewish people so much about this Jew, this rabbi, who refused to be religious with him.
Right.
Now, he kept the traditions and he did the things that he was supposed to, but he was not religious like they were, because otherwise he could not have been a friend of sinners.
Right.
And they hated it. You know, there was a preacher, evangelist once said, you know, because I've been in Pentecostal, you know, all of my adult life ever since, not all of my adult life, but since I was in my early 30s, that's how I got saved, that's where I was. So, I mean, I understand a little about Pentecostal, and I'm not trying to deviate or differentiate between denominations. We're all either saved or we're not saved, period. How we live out that salvation is a whole other thing. But I, you know, obviously I experienced a lot of the, what we would have said were signs. I mean, people getting slain in the spirit, shouting, you know, worship, demonstrative worship and all that, which I'm not against any of that. I'm just saying that by God are non-signs. Those are not signs. Those are non-signs. Those are physical things, flesh things that we identify with and go, whoa, that there must really be spiritual. Not necessarily. They could be as carnal as dirt.
Yeah.
I mean, I've had goosebumps when I just really didn't deserve goosebumps.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, I've gotten, you know, felt the presence and sensed the presence of God, had healing, deliverance, and other things happen when I was not being a perfect Christian.
Right.
Amen?
Right.
Those are non-signs.
Right.
Spiritual people, if you want to know what he calls perfect, spiritual people are simply people that understand spiritual truths.
Right.
Amen. Because I've known people who, quote unquote, operated in the spirit who didn't know sic 'em about spiritual things.
Right.
And I'm sure a lot of you have too, right? I'm not saying they're bad people. I'm just saying they operated in gifts,
right,
but they didn't have half the revelation that most of you have today.
Right.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Spiritual people simply understand spiritual truth. Amen. 1 Corinthians 2:13 again. Which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. Amen. So the spiritual person then understands spiritual truth, right? Whereas the natural person or the unspiritual person doesn't accept the things of the Spirit of God because they're foolishness to him.
Right.
You want to know if you're spiritual? Do you believe the things of God? You're spiritual. And I don't care what the other person's degree is or their position, if they don't believe the truth of the gospel, the grace of God, the fundamental teaching of the gospel, they're not spiritual.
Right.
Not by God's definition.
Right.
Praise the Lord. The spiritual person discerns spiritual things. I heard it tonight, just with this handful of us that are here tonight. And we hear it every service, Sunday, Wednesdays. Discernment.
Yeah.
When you start talking about some person that God led you to or that God spoke to you about, that's discerning. That's discernment. Amen. I mean, Tim's talking about being, at the drugstore, at a restaurant. Look, that is spiritual discernment.
Yes.
There's a connection there.
Yes.
God is feeling compassion,
yes,
for somebody, so you feel it. Why? Because it's spiritual, spirit to spirit.
Uh-huh.
Amen. So if we're discerning spiritual things, it starts with the substitutionary sacrifice of Christ for all the sins of the world. Can't say you're spiritually discerning and you don't believe that. Right? We discern that first. And from there, all of the kingdom of God operates by that same principle, grace. It begins and it flows through everything that God does. You can't just say, I was saved by grace, but now I live by the law. I was saved by grace, but now I live by my own effort. I'm not saying we shouldn't want and try to live moral lives. That's just being someone who wants to represent Christ in a way that is not a negative.
Right.
But that doesn't make you any more spiritual,
no,
than anybody else.
Right.
In fact, the more you concentrate on grace, Paul said, I am what I am.
Yeah.
And I'm that by the grace of God. He said, I've outworked everybody, and yet I didn't do anything.
Right.
It was by the grace of God,
yes,
that I did anything of any value. Praise the Lord. Because someone's talking about getting to heaven and getting rewards. I mean, what reward are you going to get? It clearly tells us, is God going to say, well, Jody, you've been really, really spiritual. You get two crowns, a necklace, and sandals.
Yeah.
Sally, not so much. We'll give you a washcloth to wash your feet because you don't have shoes. No, it's not, because whatever you get, you got to give back because it's not yours. I mean, it's not like God's got to come out like you do with your grandkids or your kids and say, look, you can only play with this. You don't get to keep it. Try to take it back. Or, I mean, I love that metaphor, taking candy from a baby. Try it sometime. You think it's like taking candy? Try that sometime. See how it works for you. Amen. We have nothing to boast about because it's all by grace. And that is the greatest revelation you can have because it opens you up then to share that grace with somebody else who doesn't deserve it any more than we deserve it. And it makes us more like God. And it makes God more attractive to the sinner. Praise the Lord. Counselors can counsel. Bible study leaders can lead. Preachers can preach. And evangelists can evangelize. Churches cannot be built on a shallow, pragmatic philosophy and call it Christian. It doesn't work. Right. It will never work. Because this isn't about the wisdom of the world. It's the wisdom of God. Foolishness to the world. Counselors are not going to be effective with leftovers of worldly wisdom.
Right.
And that's what we find with most counselors. Mm-hmm. They want to do a psychoanalysis and throw in a couple of Christian words and claim that they're Christian counselors. I'm not saying that there aren't true Christian counselors. I'm just saying most of the time what you get is some leftover world stuff with a Christian twist to it.
Right.
It doesn't work. Teachers are not effective when they're teaching half-truths.
Right.
A half-truth is worse than no truth. Because
right.
It's a deception.
That's right.
Preachers who preach grace and law preach a mixture.
Yes.
And no one benefits.
Right.
The scripture tells us that.
That's right.
The mixture God wants no part of.
And
evangelists who evangelize by fear are misrepresenting God.
Come on.
Praise the Lord. I'm not questioning their motives or their sincerity. Right. I'm just saying it's ineffective. It's ineffective. Mm-hmm. Because it's still the wisdom of the world.
Yeah.
If you break it down, if you look at it, that's what we see so much of the time in our churches. And it's no wonder that it doesn't work, that it isn't effective, that it isn't long-term effective. Wherever the revelation of God is threatened, wherever the revelation of God is assaulted, we are challenged as Christians. You know it because you see it with other Christians who, if you really tell them everything you know, praise the Lord, you're going to have a problem.
Yes.
Amen? I'm not saying you shouldn't. I'm just saying sometimes it's more confrontation than it is expression of God's love, God's goodness. Every day, this is what he talks about, having to fight the fight of faith. The just shall live by faith. Every day, we have to fight the fight of faith. And if you're going to really, if you think this just happens through some sort of osmosis or something, you're mistaken.
Right.
You seek God, and then God reveals.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is we're seeking a God, and then when God reveals himself, a lot of times we go, who's that? Because that isn't the God we were seeking. You know, we're seeking God. We're sincere about seeking God. It's just that our expectation of what this God's going to be when we find him is altogether different than what we were expecting. But God doesn't care. If you seek him, he'll reveal himself to you. Amen? Not what you want, but who he is. That's why we're here. Most of us didn't start out with the theology that we have today. I'm not saying we didn't have a fundamental theology based on the death, burial, resurrection of Jesus, but we didn't know what we know now. And I don't mean that in a bragging way. I just mean what my, if someone had asked me to define salvation and relationship with God 30 years ago, it'd be altogether different than it is now.
Yeah.
The primary, you know, coming to God would be the same, but everything else would have been different. Mm-hmm. But because I was looking for God, even though I didn't know what he looked like when I found him, amen, he was willing to reveal himself. This is the problem that the Jews had. This is the problem that the church and Christians today still have. It wasn't like they didn't look for God or didn't want to have a relationship with God. They just had already made up their mind what God was, and so when God showed up, they didn't recognize him. They weren't willing to embrace the reality of God when he revealed himself. When they got the revelation, they didn't want the revelation. They preferred their tradition. And what did God do? He stopped revealing.
Right.
He just moved on to the next person who would accept the revelation. Right. That doesn't mean he's given up on him and he's not going to have anything to do with it. I don't believe in replacement theology or anything else. The Jews are going to be saved.
Yeah. Yep.
But in the meantime, they're getting no revelation of God.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Every day we got to fight. The Bible says what the Bible... You know, you have to fight this fight of faith in order to believe everything that we know that the Bible says about God. That's a fight of faith in itself, is it not? I mean, do you not have to go back to the Scripture and say, God, that's what you told me?
Yeah.
Even though it doesn't look like this and everybody else is saying something else, you have to fight the fight of faith for the revelation, amen, that the Bible says about God. And even more challenging, you have to fight the fight of faith that challenges what the Word of God says about you.
Yeah.
I mean, I believe bigger things for God, but when it starts talking about me, then I have to swallow hard and say, whoa, I must be reading somebody else's mail. No. We can do all things.
Yeah.
Nothing is impossible to them that believe. Amen? We have to believe what it says about us by the Spirit. The Bible says, grace, grace. For every situation, Zerubbabel, he tells him, for every situation that comes to disagree with what God has said, he said, you look to the mountain, speak to this great mountain, O Zerubbabel, and just say this, grace, grace. Look at the doctor's report and just say, grace, grace. I'm telling you, it goes right back to where we read in Isaiah 53. He suffered that so that you don't have to. His peace is upon us. He had no peace. He was in chaos with all that was going on to him at the cross.
Yes.
So that we could have peace in the worst situations, in the worst circumstances.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities.
Mm-hmm.
The chastisement of our peace was upon him.
Mm-hmm.
And with his stripes, we're healed.
Yes.
That is simply shouting grace to each of those circumstances. When the enemy comes and says, well, you're still a sinner because, you know, you did this. Or you thought that. Or you said this.
Mm-hmm.
Grace. Grace.
Yes.
Read it for yourself.
Amen.
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 Oh, well, you know, you lived a pretty screwed up life for so long that now it's going to come back to bite you. I mean, there are going to be health issues. There's going to be this. There's going to be that. And you, after all, you deserve it because you didn't live the way you should have lived. And amen. Grace, grace.
Yes.
Well, you drank for 30 years. It's no wonder you got cirrhosis of the liver. And, you know, you're going to die early and you're not going to see all of God's promise. Grace,
yes.
Grace.
Come on.
Well, you were foolish with that last investment. You know, you had that job, but you didn't save like you should have. And you didn't keep this. Now you're going to have to worry about how are you going to do this? How are you going to take care? Grace,
yeah.
Grace.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Go back to Isaiah 54, if you will, again, to 9 and 10, and we'll quit with this. For this is as the waters of Noah unto me.
Yes.
What did God say about the water? I'll never do it again. I'll never destroy the earth with water again. So he's using that as the metaphor. I have sworn that the waters of Noah will never more go over the earth. Just like that, I'm swearing to you, I will not be angry with you. I will not be wroth with you. I will not rebuke you.
Yes.
He's saying, grace, grace, amen.
Yes.
For the mountain will depart,
yes,
the hills be removed, but my kindness will not depart from you.
Thank you, Lord.
Think about it. He'll never not be kind to you. Never. Never. He cannot be unkind to you. Because he has declared it by his own word. He has sworn by his own word.
Yes.
I will not. Amen. My kindness will not be apart from me. Neither will the covenant of my peace be removed, saith the Lord that has mercy on you. Grace, grace.
Yes.
It is finished. You want wisdom? You have the wisdom of the ages right there. Wisdom that men and women spend their entire lives searching for knowledge, searching for wisdom, searching for the meaning of life.
Yes.
And here we have it in our own hands, living inside of us. Now, if you don't think you're wiser than all your teachers, like David said, that's because you're using the foolishness of the world and not the wisdom of God. You have the Spirit of God. You have the mind of God.
Yes.
Operate by it.
Yes.
You'll never fail. He'll never leave you or forsake you. He's always going to be there to back you up.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Yes. You shout grace and he magnifies it.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Till everything shakes.
Yes.
And everything that can be shaken will be shaken.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
And you'll still be standing with Jesus when it's all said and done. Give him a hand clap tonight. Praise the Lord. Praise God. God bless all of you. Thank you for being here tonight. Get out of here and be graceful. Hallelujah.
Yes, amen.
Take it to him in Jesus' name.